What's up, everyone? Welcome back to Oz Hoopers TV, season 2, episode 4, featuring Will McDowell White. Very excited for this episode. Hesh, how you doing?
Man, I'm doing well. Equally excited for the episode, man. I've been off you, actually, off your hype. I've been keeping an eye on Will McDowell White. You've been hyping him up, and I'm impressed. Excited to talk to him.
Rio Grand Rally Viper, which is the G League's, Rockets G League affiliate. And now is a New Zealand breaker. So yeah, we're keen to have him on. Let's get straight into the episode. Real quick, the NBL today is Sunday when we're recording this. Perth just smacked the Kings. And Bryce Cotton, I think, now has gone against our word of Nathan Sobey being MVP. I think he's the front runner right now.
Come to the party.
Yeah, what do you reckon? You reckon?
Just as we spoke about too, we said pointy end of the season, you know, experienced vet, been here before, so he's coming to turn up now. I still think Sobey makes a case, man, you know, depending on how the Bullets finish strong this season. But exactly. It's definitely, for me, it's a two-horse race, see who kind of comes out on top.
Yeah, like I said, I think as the season plays out and Perth is at the top, it's hard to look past Bryce Cotton. But yeah, Luke Travers just had a massive game, 16 points. I'm pretty sure he didn't miss from the field. He came on and had 11 points in 3 minutes. Really solid player. What are your thoughts on Luke Travers?
I like Luke Travers a lot, man. He came out to Sydney one time, and I was working at the AUSA facility, and they were getting ready for their touring team to go over to the States to go play the AAU ball. And that was the first I heard of Travers, and a couple other guys that recruited him to come on that trip were talking him up and hyping him up. So I worked him out. I put him through a workout, and you know, we were there, and I was very impressed. He had Michigan State looking at him. He had a couple of like high major D1s that were really interested.
Yeah.
And he chose to stay in Perth, and you know, it seems to be a good decision, man. He's getting some playing time and stepping up, you know.
Yeah, very under the radar player, I reckon. He's 19.
I think he's an under the radar personality too. Like yeah. He keeps it quiet. Like he's a pretty like humble, quiet kid. Doesn't say too much. Even his personality on court, I really like it. Like he's, you know, he's got that kind of doesn't give anything away, poker face type game.
Yeah.
But at his length, I've seen him. He just clamps up, man. He defends, not afraid to defend other players, best players. Rebounds the ball well. Always in the right spot offensively. He's an unselfish type of guy. One of those guys that I think doesn't need the ball in his hands, but you look at the stat sheet at the end of the game, and he's got like, you know, 11 points, 8 rebounds, 4 assists, 3 steals and a block. And it's like, yeah, so I think bright future for Travers for sure.
I can't speak too much on him. I haven't seen too much of Travers, but I watched him at Nationals a couple games. He had a big dunk on Queensland, really big dunk. Mm-hmm. But yeah, he's a really good defender from what I've seen in the Perth games. Good lengthy forward. And yeah. I think he's a big part of that team. I know they start him and then they rip him off with after 9 minutes or so. Sometimes they don't bring him back on. But I want to see him on the court. I think he'll be a big part of their you know, run to the finals. I feel like he's nice.
Yeah, well, he signed a DP plus 2. So I think this is the second year of his contract. So he's like on a fully roster position. But even last year as DP, I think he played some meaningful minutes in crucial stages. Seems like Trevor Gleason has some trust in him, man, and relies on him heavily, and that's always a good sign as a young kid playing for an NBL team, you know. So yeah, definitely under the radar and excited to see his development. And another one that, you know, probably is going to catch the eye of some NBA teams, man, if he hasn't already.
I agree. I reckon he definitely has. He's got a couple eyes on him for sure, especially because he's so young. Another thing I want to get into real quick, we just posted a video yesterday of this young kid, Rocco. Forgive me if I get your last name wrong, but I think it's Zakarski. I went and filmed the under 16s finals, which I always love doing, because I like seeing these young guys, and I haven't really heard of many of them. I heard of one or two of them. I know LeBron Brooks as well, for those who, you know, watch Queensland basketball. But yeah, I've heard a little bit of this kid. He played Rip City. I know he's massive, but I didn't know he was 14. That is huge. 7'1" at 14. That's like, you know, that's like viral stuff. I don't know if you guys have watched the recent clip, but his footwork's nice. Did you watch the recent clip? What do you think of him?
I did. I watched that tape, man, and I didn't know he was 14 until you told me, man.
Yeah.
Like
14.
He's mobile. Crazy. He's mobile for 7-1, man. Like he can move. He looks like he's got good hands and good touch. Like he had that one little play where he got that offensive rebound and just did like the big man dunk from the spot, like just two hands in the rim. So I was like, damn, at 14, man, I'm always, you know, especially here, man. AIS, oh, sorry, Center of Excellence now. They love length at a young age, length and height. Like they look for that. So I think he's going to be recruited heavily.
Yeah, hopefully he gets the right coaching, you know, stays in shape. That's the one thing I saw about him. I'm like, usually these 7-1 guys are a bit slow on their feet. But he pulled up for a three and his form looked really good. And he was quick getting back on defense and stuff like that. Looks like he knows how to play the game. So I'm excited for his future.
Definitely. When I see that length, first thing I look for is like mobility. Like, are they able to transition from O to D and free throw line to free throw line? Like, how quick do they get up and down the floor? He looks like he's got a motor. Like, he can move and he can run and, like, you know, moving pretty well for his height.
He's aggressive. He's aggressive too. A lot of these big guys around Australia, you see, like they'll get bumped and they'll be like, you know, a bit soft. But he's angry. He's aggressive. I like it.
No, that age too. Yeah, you know how you see like long guys that don't really know like how big they are.
Yeah,
and they kind of look like Bambi, like falling over their legs and stuff.
That's what I mean.
He looks like he knows his body type. He knows he's long, he's athletic. He knows how to use it already. So
yeah,
let's keep an eye on him. Or you keep an eye on him, especially.
With the Australian system bringing these players up, we were discussing something the other week. What are your thoughts on the specific topic of the national teams is what we were talking about. A couple players, because I was looking at the teams, I'm like, there's a couple people that aren't playing and I've been asking around, like, why aren't you playing States and stuff like that? And a lot of them have been saying, like, can't afford it. You know, what are your thoughts on that? I know you were a little bit, like, frustrated.
Of course, man. I got thoughts for real. Listen, without knowing the full story, obviously, I'm not involved in, like, state team selection. I'm not involved in nationals and BNSW or Basketball Australia in any way.
Yeah.
But I have a fair bit to do with the players that kind of play at that level. Well, from New South Wales anyway. And it disappointed me a little bit that certain guys don't get the opportunity to play nationals who can't afford it. First, I didn't know that you had to pay, and it's a ludicrous amount of money from what I'm told to play. So this is just off like my sources. Like, I'm not saying if it's wrong, I'm open to being corrected by all means. But from what I've been told, it's like a fair bit of money. And if you can't afford it, it's like, you know, you rarely get assistance. It's like, you can get a payment plan, but you end up have to paying the money. And that's one of the biggest things I find, like, in the States. Anyway, if like I'm just comparing, if you're a young player, like, you know, 14, 15 to like 17, 18, guys will come and take care of you in terms of the basketball side of things, because like you're too talented to let go. We can't afford to have one of our youngest players not performing in the big stages and be in the eyes of the big coaches and the scouts and things like that. So I don't know where the hole in the system is. I don't know how they're going to get funding. I don't know if that's the actual issue, but like you got certain kids like that are just super talented. Like one of my close guys, like Buru, you know, you just dropped a tape in recently. I was working him out. Like, man, this guy's 6'6", 6'7", crazy. Jumps out the gym, crazy athlete. Like arguably one of the best wings in the country for his age in terms of talent. Like he can't fall through the cracks. You know what I mean?
No, exactly. That's one of the upsetting things.
Like I don't care what it takes. Like he needs to be playing from what I think. And yeah, it's just sad. I don't think he's the only one. I think there's probably a few other cases like that, you know?
100%. 100%. Yeah. It's a little bit frustrating because, you know, all eyes are on this nationals tournament, the under 20s. It's a biggest stage. And to see some kids, you know, who should definitely be on the team, let alone be the star of the team, or possibly, you know, they'll put up great numbers. You know, for example, I could get this name wrong again, but David Oquera.
Yeah.
He had a great nationals. He was on the radar a little bit, but he had a great nationals last nationals and it put his name on the map. You know, he got college offers, Arkansas, all those other type of colleges. You know, it's big. It's big to play in these tournaments and to see that like players like Buru, for example, you know, in his situation or whatever, not being able to play. It sucks, you know. I feel like it's okay. I don't know. I'm not in the position to talk about it because I don't know what's going on behind closed doors or, you know, with everything they pay for and such, but I kind of understand it for rep levels, because the rep level isn't a, you know, how do I say it? It's not a one-off tournament, but it's like, it's not as big as a company as Basketball Australia or Basketball Queensland, or like your local rep comp can't really afford to like pay for you to travel or whatever. But nationals, like
state, man. You're talking about the 10 best players in the state.
Exactly. 10 best. Like some of these state teams you're looking at and you just like, that isn't the 10 best players in the state. You can name five, like, you know, off rip. But, you know, I don't know.
And I agree. I agree with what you said. I think it's clear. I think it's very important to state that, obviously, like, I don't want to sound like I'm just bitching and moaning about nothing. It's like, I understand. It's disappointing. But it's like, I want to be a part of the solution. I want to find out, like, how can we get those guys to play? Like, is there efforts being put in to do that? Because I'm not sensing it. If there is, I mean, like I said, I'm open to correction, but I'd love for there to be that kind of effort to get guys on the map to be like, no, this guy's elite and we need him. And like, if I was in, like, for instance, New South Wales, I'd be doing whatever I could to get Buru, man. Like, it's just a no-brainer. You know what I mean? Like, it shouldn't just be like, oh, can you afford it? No. All right, cool. I'll pick the next guy.
Yeah.
What? Like, I don't know.
Yeah, I agree. I think they do something in the States where if like an older guy has a lot of money and he sees this young guy struggling a little bit and like they think he can really, you know, make it to the league, they will invest them to play in these tournaments and travel and stuff like that. And then, I mean, I don't know if they get paid back or whatever. I don't know how it works, but I think that's, you know, I don't know. You got to find solutions to fix this stuff.
Of course. It's always dangerous, man, when you start like toying with it and putting pressure on a kid to want to make it and paying for all this stuff. Like, you don't want to go down that route, but it's like, you got to somehow figure out a way to get these kids to play. I've even seen situations like guys that I know that have played state or nationals before and got their fees, not waived, but like, oh, you can go on a payment plan, and then they don't pay back in full, and then BNSW or whoever just go, no, you're not allowed to play anymore representative games or represent Australia again or do any of these things unless you pay your money back. And it's like, man, these kids are like talented. And this is not like, just like some guys that are like, oh, pretty good at basketball. These are like the next best stars, potentially going to be at Boomers camps and D1 college offers and NBL players. And it's like, they have an option now. Do you want to set them up for their career and put them on the map? Or is it like, you know, I don't know. I would love to know what the problem is. And I'd love to know, get to the root of how we can solve that problem. But we can't be losing guys.
I agree. Well said. Next thing, earlier this week, on a better note, well, it depends how you look at it. Bawali Bales has left Hawaii.
Yeah.
The Rainbow Warriors. He's decided to come back and play professionally in Australia. What were your initial thoughts? Let's hear it.
So I spent a lot of time with Bawali, and I talked to him a lot during his freshman year, and obviously worked him out a lot. And he's back in town now in Sydney, so I'm looking forward to working out with him again when he's out of quarantine. So my initial thoughts were, I was very happy for him. I've kind of like, I talked to him about it all. And when he was kind of telling me like, that's the situation and that's what he thinks, I was like, yo, it's a great opportunity for you. I think it's really important. Like, guys like that at his age really start to take control of those decisions and figure out like what they think is best for them.
Mm-hmm.
And he seems like he's got his head switched on as to why he's doing certain things and what he wants. So when I first found out, I was excited for him. I thought it was a great opportunity. And, you know, he told me he's going to weigh it up and see what happens. And, you know, it blew up a little bit. Like, as soon as he announced it, there's a lot of people talking about it now. So see where he ends up, man.
The reports are Sydney Kings are interested. And also Illawarra Hawks are interested. I think there'll be more teams as time goes on.
I think a few teams have reached out to him now.
Yeah.
On a superficial level. Obviously, it's still NBL season right now, so there's some bigger things to worry about. And then signing periods, you know, around July, I think, is when they look to sign. So, but there's been some initial interest from what I hear and from what he's kind of mentioned. So it's going to be interesting.
Yeah. Bawali is easily one of the top players in his age group out of the country. Easily one of the best scorers, I feel like. If you need a bucket, I don't know if I'd want anyone. I don't know if I'd want the ball in anyone else's hands.
Yeah, he kind of he's one of those guys that's like that's what impressed me about him. And I'm trying to keep the bias out of it because I've grown close with him over the last 2 years since I've kind of worked him out. But like he's one of those guys that like wills his willpower is like pretty unbelievable. Like he wills that ball. Like you know, you watch that South Australia game with a three ball. It's like I wouldn't call him a sniper. I'm not gonna say he's like a sniper, but he's like for some reason when you need a bucket, like you said, like that ball just goes in the hoop.
Yeah, exactly. I'm huge on Bawali's game. One of my favorite players to watch by far. How do you reckon
spend enough time with him though? You find out he's a headache, man.
He's not gonna like that one. how do you think he's gonna fit in the NBL?
It's all depends on usage rate. He's a high usage guy, man. He needs the ball in his hands. It's one thing that I tried to like. I was talking to him about during his college season. Like he wasn't used to his level of what he wanted to, how he felt like most comfortable. He's one of those guys who needs the ball in his hands. And, you know, don't get twisted. He can play off the ball and he's pretty good, but it's like you get the best out of him when the ball's in his hands. So for him personally, I think it's going to be a matter of just adjusting to the pros, bigger bodies, faster pace. Like you're not guarding a 17-year-old, 18-year-old kid anymore. You're guarding Bryce Cotton now. Like that's slightly different now. You know what I mean? Yeah. So yeah, and he's gotten away, not gotten away, but he's been elite defensively and we've seen that. Can that transition to the NBL? I think it can. He's a fast learner and he'll get there. But I think initially the Kings are going to have to – it's going to be interesting for him to see how they utilize him. If he gets the ball in his hands a lot and he's able to do his thing, I think he'll adjust to it pretty quickly and he'll be pretty effective. You know, we've seen like Giddy be effective with the ball in his hands. I think Bawali can – obviously it goes about it differently to Giddy, but he can be effective, man. He can be an impact player at a young age. So I'm hoping that they put some faith in him, if it's the Kings. I don't know, it might be the Hawks, it might be whoever else, but – hoping wherever he lands, they put some faith in him to go out and make plays. And he's a high-risk, high-reward type guy, you know?
Yeah, exactly. Obviously, very elite defender. I think what you said with the system basketball sort of stuff, he's got to adjust. And, you know, it's like he's been playing his whole life where he gets the ball at the top of key and you do your thing. But it's just adjusting to, like, you know, being the third or fourth option in the NBL.
It might start like that for sure.
It will start like that. That's like for Hawaii, for example. You're coming in. These guys have been playing 4 years. Mm-hmm. You know, freshman guard. You can't expect to, you know, play through you. You know, but
yeah,
I don't know.
And that's something that him like. That's his like. Yeah, that's like, one thing that stands out about him. He's hungry for that. Like, you know, he's like, I don't care if I'm a freshman. That was his approach. He's like, yeah, they look at me like a freshman, but I don't care. I'm guarding seniors. Like, I'm guarding whoever.
That's a good thing, though.
Yeah, exactly. And that's what's probably got him to the stage that he's at right now. The fact that he just hasn't cared at all at any point in time. He backs himself, has confidence in his game. And if that continues and he ends up in the right situation, then we'll see some big things from him, man.
Do you think he should have tried staying NBL instead of going to Hawaii? Or do you think it was a good learning curve?
Personally, I think it was great for him, man. I think it was good for him to go experience that. Like I said, I can't, it's impossible for me to say whether it's better or worse than if he would have stayed. Like, I think it's the main thing is he made a decision based on what was happening at the time and he had college setting his sights and he got himself a D1 scholarship and he took it, man. He had a few schools interested. So I think it was a good learning curve for him. Showed him a little bit, obviously, like just how it is in other places and got him probably toughened him up a little bit mentally as well, being away from home and probably not getting the most out of his basketball that he would have anticipated. So I think overall good decision, but I'm glad to see him come back home and you know, explore his professional career and start that off.
Me too. I'm keen. I'm keen for if Kings get him. I'm keen for the Kings season next season.
Yeah, well, if they get him, for sure.
Yeah, might be a Kings fan. All right, we got Will McDowell joining us. Super excited. One of my favorite players. 22 years old. Just averaged 3-3-3 in the G League and has decided to come back to the Breakers. We'll pick his brains a little bit and see how he's going. Woke up, talking like me. Oh, I think they like me. Yup, in my white tee. Yup, no, baby, smoke so much, don't need some vice. Dion don't like me, but act it like me. All of y'all toy day parties don't invite me. That you wife, she's so trifling. I've been getting money, so don't. What's up, Will? How you doing?
Going on, fellas? How you doing, man?
Not much. Just want to introduce you to Hesh. She's going to be co-hosting the show with us.
How you doing, bro?
Good. How are you?
Good, man. Good.
How's quarantine? You quarantining right now?
Yeah. Man, this shit's so boring.
How many days you got left?
I'm actually out tomorrow in the morning.
Oh, that's right. Straight into training.
Yeah, I got some medical stuff to do. Workouts, some 510 in the afternoon.
That's right. Where you at right now? You guys, I know New Zealand has been on the road a bit because COVID, but where are you at right now?
I'm in Sydney right now. And then tomorrow I'm in Melbourne.
When's your first debut game?
I believe it's in Perth.
Okay. That'll be big. Perth
on like Thursday or something like that next week.
Okay. Tough. All right, we'll get straight into the questions. We'll start off with your early life and getting into basketball. How'd you get into basketball?
I was just through dad. Obviously dad was a AFL player. I think it was just, something came about it at school. And, dad was just trying to get us into everything, every kind of sport. And, since then we just the whole family's just stuck with it.
How long have you been playing basketball for?
Yeah, probably since I was five or six.
Okay.
Playing organized. I didn't think I'd take it up seriously until I was forced to by dad, pretty much.
Your dad obviously played AFL professionally for 14 years. What was his influence like on your sporting career? Was he a big influence?
Oh, yeah, he was huge. He was probably the biggest influence for all of us, really, because he did it for 14 years at the top. Yeah. Winning three premierships is like, you can't really, you can't go wrong with that.
Exactly.
Like there's no wrong way to go about it. So he would just give us, his input every, whenever we needed it. And, it's obviously helped us so far. So hopefully he does keep it up. And, he should be proud of what he's done for us.
Obviously, dad won three premierships, like you said. Was he ever hustling you to get on, like, to stay with AFL? Or was he mad when you picked basketball? Or
Nah. He wanted me to stay with basketball. There was a point where I was kind of leaning towards footy a lot. It was a quick conversation with him. He kind of just said, you're not playing footy, you're playing basketball. So, at a young age, you're not going to mess with your dad if he says that to you. So, obviously it worked out. He knew better than me at that point. I'm glad he told me to stay with it.
For sure, man. Hey, obviously you see a lot of elite athletes that have, moms and dads that have played in the elite level as well. Is there like one bit of advice that your dad's given you that kind of sticks to you to this day, if you had to narrow it down to one?
Probably just watching you, hang around the kind of people you associate with. You can easily go down the wrong path once you've, quote unquote, made it professionally. And I think that's the best thing he's done. He's kind of he's guided us to keep away from, the off court stuff that can harm our career and our bodies.
Yeah. When did you start to take basketball really seriously? When did you think, like, damn, I'm actually, a high-level player?
Probably when I was – I probably had to make a decision when I was 15, but when I thought I could really play was probably when I was 16. I went to Adidas Nations.
Yeah.
My first year there and had a really good good 6 days or however long it is. And from then I thought, man, I could, I could take this pretty far. So yeah. That's probably the point where I really thought I can really do this.
You play anyone big at Adidas Nations? I know there's some big names that go there.
Oh shit, everybody was there. Like people like Dennis Smith, Lonzo, Chase Tatum.
That's
like, all the boys were there.
In 2013, you were announced to the under-16s Australian FIBA squad. Was that your first announcement to an Australian team?
Yeah, that was the first one. That was pretty exciting.
Explain that experience of being picked for Australia and representing your country.
It's actually crazy because, I know it's not the senior level, but you never really think you're going to make a an Australian team, especially because I think at the time I was only 14.
Yeah.
I was 14. I think my brother was 15. So, like, to do that at 14 is, like, exactly. That's, like, pretty crazy, you know? Like, you don't even know what basketball is, like, where it's going to go.
Exactly.
And, like, just getting the jersey presentation was just crazy. I was, like, I honestly thought I was going to cry when I went back to my room. I was, like, holy shit. No way. There was no way I just did this, you know?
Yeah.
And, but that was probably, yeah, that was the first experience where I was, like, Jesus, basketball can really take you anywhere.
Yeah. How'd you guys go to that tournament?
I think that was in Melbourne. I think we played in Melbourne. I think that was the one we won that. We beat New Zealand pretty good in the final.
Yeah.
We had a stacked team. So
who was on that?
We had like Jack White was there. Yeah. DJ. I think Isaac was on there. I can't remember if he was there or not, because there was one team where Isaac didn't play with us.
Yeah,
I'm not sure if that was that one. Tom Wilson was there. Matt Owies, obviously, Daryl, Kyle Clark. You know, a lot of guys who went to college, high majors, and a lot of guys who are playing back here.
You also made the under-19s team, is that right?
Yeah, yeah.
In 2015, how'd you guys go in that one? You guys win that one as well, or?
Nah. I think we came fifth.
Okay.
I think fifth or seventh, one of those. I think, yeah, the US took that one out pretty easy.
That was a Worlds, was it?
Yeah, yeah, in Greece. They had that was like, yeah, Jason Tatum, Terrence Ferguson, Harry Giles, just a whole bunch of NBA players.
Who'd you guard?
Well, thankfully we didn't play the US.
Thankfully.
Oh, okay. Because I know if we played them, I probably would have asked if I could not play that game. No way I was on that.
We'll get into your pro career. In 2016, after these Australian sides, you got asked to play in the Nike Hoop Summit. For people who don't know, the Nike Hoop Summit is like juniors in the USA, and they versus the junior world team. You're in the team with DeAndre Ayton, Lauri Markkanen, Thon Maker, Harry Froehling. Explain that whole situation. How'd you get recruited?
I'm actually not sure, because I think I got added to it pretty late.
Okay.
The team was kind of already set, and then I think I just got added late to it. Obviously, you know, I guess someone said something to someone else, and I got to that. That was crazy. So it's like, it's in Portland, so you practice at the Blazers practice facility. You go to the Nike headquarters, or that's, then you play in the Motor Center. Like, you pretty much get the full NBA experience in a sense. And that was probably my favorite week of basketball that I've had, besides before we got smacked by 40. But
Nike hook you up, obviously, with a bunch of gear and stuff. And
oh yeah, probably too much, I'd say. I didn't know if I was going to make it back with all those back.
That's dope. By 17, you've gone to Greece, all around America, playing basketball. That sounds like, you know, dream come true. You are obviously close with Harry Froehling. You guys play QSL together on that team. Do you have any funny stories from that trip?
I have one, but I can't.
I was going to say.
You guys are public figures now, man. You got to be careful what you say.
Yeah, I'm not trying to. I don't make Harry look bad right now. So that's my boy. So I got to take care of it.
Yeah. Was it the end of 2016? You were a DP for the Kings.
Yeah. Towards the end of that. Yeah.
How was that recruiting process like? Did the Kings reach out to you? And what was the overall experience like playing for the Kings?
Yeah. So I was doing prep school for a bit. And that situation just didn't work out at all. Someone who lives in Sydney, I think it might have been Tim Hudson, maybe. Someone like that just kind of passed the message on to Jeff Van Gonigan. And Jeff and my dad know each other. They've known each other for a while. So it was a pretty easy connection there to work that out. But I think it was more so just because I was ready to come back and just, ready to play. But that was a cool experience, man. Like, I had Kevin Lish, Brad Newley.
Yeah.
And now Jace at the Borsk. I had Jace there. Like, Josh Powell, who I think he won a championship with Kobe 1 year. Like, I had a bunch of, like, just, like, legends in basketball around me. And I didn't – I really, because I was only 18, I didn't really know what to do. Like, I don't think I spoke the whole season because I didn't know what to say. I was like, if I say the wrong thing, they're probably going to look at me different. So I kind of just stayed in my own place. But it was cool, man. Like, Drewy's first year of coach, which was pretty funny. You know, he was obviously in just player mentality.
Yeah.
You know, Copes is a bit of a legend. But, yeah, I loved it in Sydney. Loved it.
That's cool. Did you ever have college aspirations? Was that ever on the cards?
Yeah, it was. It was for a bit. Then once, you know, it was a bit tough once the whole school side of it came into it. It was just tough knowing what subjects and how many classes to do at that time. Yeah. You know, not many people, especially from Brisbane, weren't going to school. So
yeah.
It was hard to kind of ask around what to do. And, I think, like, I missed a couple of classes back at school, and it just, yeah, there was kind of no way it was gonna work out.
Yeah, I think that's a big point for, like, younger guys. Tell me if I'm right, Will, but, like, just the academics associated with it. It's not just like you go there and hoop 24/7. Like, you're a student athlete and you got to, like, hit the books, and there's a lot of commitment with that side of.
Oh yeah, like, I even went to so when I was in prep school, I actually went to Fresno State for 2 weeks with Daryl before, you know, he started the school year or whatever, and I didn't see Daryl from like 6 a.m. till like 8 p.m. I did not see him until, because obviously, you know, I wasn't enrolled in school, so I wasn't doing anything. I was just basically in the room all day, go to the facility a bit and get some shots up or whatever. But yeah, like, it's just constant class, workout, class, practice. Like, then you gotta do all this study hall stuff that they were talking about that I wasn't listening to, but like they're just on the go, like 24/7. Like, it's a yeah. tough life, but, you know, you just gotta, like they say, it's gotta kind of be built different for it mentally to get through that.
I saw after that you signed a 4-year deal in Germany. I did not know that. Explain how that came about.
So my agent was at Summer League, and just one of the GMs just approached him. The GM from the German club, Bamberg, just approached him and asked what I was doing. And he just told him he's available if you want to sign him. And then, yeah, they just signed me to that 4-year deal. I only stayed for about a year and a half. But honestly, that was a great experience. You know, just being overseas on the other side of the world was cool. Yeah. Experiencing new culture and stuff, and being in the Euroleague, you get to travel around the whole of Europe, especially for Euroleague games. So I was doing that a lot, and it didn't end well, but I still enjoyed it.
What was it like playing internationally? What's the competition like?
Well, not many people will know this, but those guys over there they're tough.
Yeah,
they're like, people over here don't really know how good those guys are over there.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, no, I understand, you know, they don't have the games over here on TV and things like that.
Yeah.
But I think, you know, if people went over there and had a look at the way they play compared to, now I'm not saying the NBL is bad, because it's definitely not.
Yeah.
The NBL, it's a top tier league.
Yeah, exactly.
But over there, yeah, it's just, I think over there it's a lot more physicality and their IQs are just through the roof.
Yeah, I've seen some mixtapes on Instagram of some of these passes. And some of the passes they're pulling off are insane. Like,
and it's just like, they just do it so effortlessly. It's like they're playing out of the park, really, sometimes. Yeah. But yeah, because they just have...
That's something that I've noticed about European basketball, like the IQ that you said, like, it's a lot more structured and it's a lot more kind of like chess. NBA is obviously, like, we watch that and we love the highlights and the talent level and the athleticism. Yeah, exactly. It's like, Euroball is a little bit different. What's the structure, if you don't mind me asking, if you remember, what's the structure like of the leagues? Because I think everyone just has this idea that you go to Europe and it's just like one league, but there's like hundreds of leagues, every country, 2 or 3 leagues, you know.
Well, I know for Germany, I think there's like 4 or 5 different, you know, like divisions, I guess.
Yeah.
So, you know, the top one's the BBL, then the Pro A, Pro B, and it keeps going down. And it's, so, yeah, the way it works is, like, the top 2 teams from each league move up, and the bottom two move down. Yeah. And then, like, obviously teams in the top league, they'll most of them will play in, like, either EuroLeague, EuroCup or Champions League. So most teams in the first league are playing in, like, you know, two different leagues at the same time.
Yeah. I guess that's similar to, like, their football, like when you have Champions, UEFA Champions League and an EPL and then, you know.
Yeah, it's literally, yeah, exactly the same. Exactly the same as soccer.
You mentioned before that you went to the Summer League and your agent got picked up by a Germany guy or whatever. What was the Summer League like? Who'd you play for? How'd you get in contact to go play in the Summer League? And yeah, explain how that experience was.
Yeah, I was with Houston, obviously. That was when Daryl Morey was GM. Daryl kind of said he'd been watching me for a couple of years and just wanted me to get over there and have a chance. So he just hit my agent and we said, obviously we'll take the opportunity. And just like what I was saying about the EuroLeague, it's it's tough because a lot of guys are trying to get deals out of it.
Yeah, exactly.
So they're playing 100 miles an hour, just all this energy, shots going up. Like Damian Lillard, as soon as they step over half court, it's going up.
Yeah,
just to show they can shoot. It was tough because I was just coming off surgery, so you know I could only play literally. If I played 10 minutes and 1 second, like I was in trouble because I wasn't allowed to do it. So obviously I wish I would have played more, but you know, you can control what you control. But once again, it's cool. You know, just playing overseas, it's a different experience.
What's the mental side of it like? Because I can imagine Summer League, man, it's like you said, like everyone's vying for a contract. You know, they're all trying to be the top dog. Do you try and go like team type of guy? Like, I'm going to be a guy that can throw an extra pass and get in there. Or are you just like, all right, I'm going to just try and drop 20, 25 this game right now?
That's kind of frustrating when you're trying to make a name for yourself and everyone's thinking like, this is my time to shine. ISO ball, you know?
Exactly. I think, for our team, so we had Chris Clemens who...
He's on the Rockets right now, I think.
The top, he's like the third leading NCAA scorer of all time or something.
Yeah.
So we knew he was our scorer. That was the first thing. We knew he was the main guy they were trying to showcase. So my main thing was just, I think he could make me look good by making shots.
Yeah.
Off me, you know, penetrating, dishing to him. And then we had Isaiah Hartenstein, big man rolling to the rim, and Gary Clark who can stretch the floor. So, I just went in there just to play natural. I didn't want to show them something I'm not, because, you know, that's not really going to get me anywhere. So I came in just trying to be a team guy. And I think the thing that I don't realize is, like, especially in Summer League, it's the teams that play together that always win. Like, you never really see the most talented team win because, you know, a bunch of them are just trying to get deals and trying to get their own.
Talk to us about entering your name in for the NBA draft. How'd you go about it?
Oh, man, I think my agent did all that for me. I didn't really have a say. that was cool. The first year I did, it was more just to get exposed to that, to those type of workouts and things like that for the next year, which I think I had more workouts the first year, whereas the second year we kind of planned it out a bit smarter. So we only go to teams who were really, you know, trying to look at me and see if there's a possibility of anything that could happen. But that's a grind, bro. Like, holy shit.
Yeah. It's all exciting.
I remember one time I got to like OKC at midnight, had to be up at like 5:30 to do all this testing and then work out. Then, you know, you got to fly to the opposite side of the country and do another workout the next day.
Yeah.
Like a lot of that stuff going to happen, so you got to be mentally just locked into the max.
Run us through an example. What do they put you through? Is it just scrimmaging or are they some shooting drills or?
Yeah, man. Oh, usually it's like, you know, you get loose with some finishing, and then they'll start off with a lot of skill work, and then basically you just might go one on ones and two on twos and three on threes, because you know they only do six guys in a workout. And then, you know, some teams will have, like, specific tests they want to do. So, like, I know Phoenix, they do the 3-minute run. How many, you know, up and downs you can do in 3 minutes.
Yeah.
Like, the Lakers do a certain shooting drill.
Did you get your 30 in 3 minutes?
No, I did not.
Yeah. Up on an NBA court too, I bet.
I was like, no, that's an extra 2 meters, so I'm just gonna do what I can do.
We'll speak about the G League now. You obviously played G League with the Rockets G League affiliate. What are your thoughts on the G League?
Oh man, I think it's probably faster than the NBA, to be honest.
Yeah, I've noticed that. The when I look at the G League box scores, there's a lot of high scorers up there. You know,
yeah, it's ridiculous. I mean, yeah, we averaged like 120 points in the bubble this year, something like that. Yeah, it's just so fast because it's literally like what I was saying about the summer league. Guys are just trying to get call ups, get these 10 days, 2 ways, and things like that. So, and like I said, the summer league, it's the same thing. Like the teams that win and play together are the ones that get call ups. Like I know my first year, we only had one. I think we only had one call up for the whole year. And there was a team. I think it was Memphis Hustle. They, as far as individual talent, they were nowhere near us. But yeah. I think their whole team got called up because they were the first seed in the West.
Yeah.
But guys are just, it's just the same thing. Like you can tell the teams like who they're trying to showcase. You know, you go to, like, I know in the bubble they had Jalen Lecque was shooting everything for Indiana's G League team. No, we had Kevin Porter.
Yeah.
Who was just going off every single game. KJ Martin was killing it too. So it's a lot like summer league in a way.
Okay.
Which is it hurts the international players that come in because obviously all they've done for 20 years is play, you know, make the right play, make the right pass, take the right shots. And you know, some guys over here just come out there and just blaze away.
What was it? I was gonna get into Kevin Porter and Kenyon KJ. What was it like training with those guys?
Well, the thing, like, I only had one practice. Because I was in Sydney for 2 weeks waiting for my visa. Then I do the 6-day quarantine in Orlando. So, yeah, I only got out the day before. But my first impression of KP was he was just a clown. Like, coach would be talking and he's just out there, like, joking around. I'm just like, this guy's like, he's a little kid. Like, he's going to be the reason we win it or the reason we lose it. And then you got KJ, who's the exact opposite on the court, who's just serious 24/7. But, you know, off the court, everyone's the same. We're all big kids off the court. But, Kevin Porter's probably the most talented player I've ever played with.
Yeah. That's out of doubt. You've been playing with a lot of people. He got caught up to the Rockets recently. He's doing his thing in the NBA.
You did mention something I wanted to just touch on. I think it's a good thing for people to understand. You did mention like 10 days and 2 ways. I think you signed an exhibit 10, is that right?
Yeah.
So can you just run us through like the different types of contracts and the difference between like you know, a full-time guaranteed contract and the 2 ways and the 10 days and how it all works?
If you know, it's hard to explain. Yeah, like an exhibit 10 is hard to explain.
Yeah, I was gonna say I've never heard of an exhibit 10.
It's like I think every like NBA team has like four affiliate spots they can give to players, which is, I think it's more like basically other teams can't touch them, I think, or can't trade for them unless it's a call up, or you know, get those call ups in 10 days and stuff. Then obviously, you got the 10-day where you're there for 10 days. Then the two-way is you can spend 45 days with the NBA team, and then the rest you're down in the G League. And then obviously guaranteed is guaranteed. And
so is that the progression, like 10 days to 2 ways to guaranteed? Is that the three?
Yeah. Some guys have like non-guarantees where they have to make it – basically they have to make it to a certain date without getting cut. And then on that date, their contract becomes guaranteed.
Gotcha.
Yeah. At the start of this season, you had a lot of interest from multiple NBL teams, and you chose to go back to the G League, and now you're back. What changed your mind?
I think because I wasn't really even going to come back after the bubble would finish. I was going to stay over there and just like work out and things like that. But then New Zealand just kind of kept calling and said that they need another creator out there. And so me and my agent, we watched the games, and we just thought, yes, I mean, it's probably a good time to go back. You know, it's been, I think, like 5 years since I played here.
Yeah.
You know, it's a different league. More, you know, as a player, I'm more mature and things like that. So be good to be back and just show people how things have changed.
Was there any other options? Why the Breakers?
Well, I had, Brisbane were talking to me for a bit. Pretty much all bubble until a certain point. They said they didn't need me, so I said that's fine. I think Illawarra were a little bit interested. Perth have asked about, you know, of a multi-year deal over the next couple of years. But yeah, other than that, that was about it. But yeah, just because New Zealand was just
kept knocking on your door,
just calling every day. It's like we need someone to help tie. We need someone to help tie. And
yeah,
it was kind of weird because I was sitting there like they have other guards on the team already. I thought they'd be looking for a big man with the minutes that Colton's playing. But I mean, yeah, they just kept coming and coming. So we went with it.
Are you excited to come home? Were you excited to come home, sir?
Yeah, I was ready to get out of there.
Yeah,
it's just crazy. It's crazy over there, the way they're dealing with this stuff over there. It's just ridiculous. I was ready to come home a while ago.
Yeah. What are your goals for this season? What do you want to achieve?
Oh, I mean, man, just help these guys win some games. Just come in and, you know, just make people see what's changed from, you know, years ago. And you know, I know a lot of people haven't seen me play. While obviously playing overseas, it's a bit harder to watch, but I guess to show people that I'm kind of worthy of being named in that Boomer squad.
Yeah, and that's our next topic: getting named into the Boomer squad. That was a huge announcement. Were you expecting it?
I was not. I was not at all. I didn't think this call would come for at least another couple of years.
Yeah.
But yeah, I got a call from David Patrick. He said someone from the Basketball Australia office is going to give you a call soon. So I didn't know what it was about at that time. And then it was Gorge who actually called my phone, and I was like, all right. It was kind of what do you want? And then they asked if I want to play, and I was like, oh, absolutely. Like, you know, I know it's going to be because this team is so, this even the squad is so talented. Yeah. Like this is easily a medal team for sure. Like I'm kind of going to approach camp like I have a chance, but I know it's going to be a long shot.
Yeah.
But I'm just going to go in there as if, you know, I've got and just give myself the best opportunity. If I make it, if not, then I set myself up for future things.
Yeah.
Me and Reese spoke about it when the squad came out. And yeah. For what it's worth, man, we both think you're a crack, man. I think yeah, they could use
100%.
Sure.
Yeah, it's definitely a long shot because there's a couple NBA names in there, and there's a couple guys that, you know, made the squad previously. But I reckon you go kill it at training camp, you got a real good shot at getting in.
Yeah, yeah, I think it's more just going in with confidence, I think.
Yeah.
Just, you know, just going in and thinking I can make a team instead of just being, you know, just another guy there.
Yeah, it's going to be cool training with all Ben Simmons and that.
It's going to be all the board.
Such a good experience. Yeah. After averaging 25 points a game and 9 rebounds, 6 assists, and putting together one of our toughest mixtapes we have on the page, I've seen Kobe and Daryl assigned to Red City. Is there any chance we'll see you put that jersey on this season?
Oh, shit. No, that's probably, yeah, it's probably a long shot. I don't really think it's going to happen. Obviously, I wish it did, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, I think Kobe should have played with us last year. He probably would have won if we had it. But, you know, like that would be pretty cool to play with
two brothers.
You know, both of them instead of just Daryl.
Yeah.
You know, it was cool playing against Kobe last year. It was pretty cool.
Yeah.
I remember one session I switched onto him. And I was going to do the whole Coach K slap the floor kind of. But, you know, I think as soon as I yelled switch, he gave it straight back to Tamari or something. So
yeah,
that was a bit crazy.
All right, we're going to get into our 10 quick questions. We do this every week with our guests. The first question is, who's someone you try and mold your game around?
Oh, probably Chris Paul, as far as pick and rolls, stuff like that. I mean, it's probably the person I watch the most, just to learn.
Nice, I like that. You good?
All right. Question two. Sorry, man. I was tripping. Okay. What's the best on-court highlight you've ever had that you can remember?
Oh,
there's got to be a few.
Probably the dunk on Northside.
Yeah, I was going to say, that's going to be the best.
I wish I got the one against Spartans, though. That's the one I wish I got.
Yeah, that was big. That was real big. Yeah, you dunked it. And I was filming on the baseline, and the guy slid to my feet, and I like filmed. I like looked down like that, and his head was like on me. I was like, "Oh my
God!" The worst thing is, I've known him for years.
Yeah,
and I played with him real fun in juniors. So,
you mean the best thing is that you've known him for years.
Yeah. Did he text you after the game?
No, he was texting everyone else.
Oh right.
Well, I don't know why he's doing that. All right.
Who's your favorite artist? Who's in the headphones?
Oh, that would be Michael Jackson, 100%.
Interesting. Pre-game?
Yeah, and anytime.
Damn.
No. Okay.
Nice. All right. What about favorite coach or most kind of influential coach?
That would be my coach. In, I had two coaches in Germany. One was Andrea Trinchieri. As far as X's and O's, he's an absolute genius. He gets called up to the NBA all the time, but says no. And then the other one was Mario Dugunjic. He would just really took care of me off the court when some stuff happened back home while I was overseas. So those two have helped me out the most on and off the court.
Just before I get into the next question, was language barrier really a thing in Germany? Would you have a translator or?
No. So everyone in the organization spoke English well. So yeah, I didn't have any problem with that at all.
That's all right. Who's your favorite teammate of all time?
Oh man,
it's hard to pick one.
it actually is when you play so many teams, it's.
You probably get your brothers.
Yeah, like I don't want to make it obvious to say that because they obviously are, but I don't want to. You know, probably DJ, to be honest.
Okay.
Because, yeah, me and DJ, we play well together.
Yeah. He's killing it this season.
Oh, he's strong.
Yeah.
All right, what about on the court? Favorite position that you like to play? I think I know, but...
Yeah, that'd be point guard.
Yeah.
For sure. You just control everything.
Who's the hardest player you've had to guard? I think you said... Kevin Porter.
Yeah, probably Kevin. Maybe even Jalen Green too.
Yeah, Jalen Green. How'd he go against you guys? You guard him a couple of times. How'd he go?
Yeah, I think I guarded him twice. He got to the rim both times. I mean, you know, we were up by like 25, so it didn't really matter.
Yeah.
Probably those two.
All
right, what about NBA, who's winning the chip this year?
Oh my God. Okay. Well, I mean, the way Brooklyn are signing right now.
Yeah. Crazy.
Yes.
Lakers picked up Drummond, but.
So I think it might have to be, I don't know if I can pick, but it'll be a Lakers Brooklyn finals, I think.
How should you think?
I said Lakers a few weeks ago, I must stay strong. I mean, I'm a converted LeBron. I just can't, like, man, he's unbelievable, man. I can't bet against him anymore. Can't do it.
Yeah. It's hard to go past the Nets. I think Nets will win. Too many stars. Every time someone touches the ball, it's in the hands of an all-star, you know? So,
yeah.
Next question. Favorite basketball shoe?
That'll be Kobe 4s.
All right.
Sure.
I think someone else said Kobe 4s. Who was that?
Rain. Could have been Rain.
Rain said Kobe 4s too.
Yeah.
Yeah. Couple of shoes. I like Kobe 4s as well. All right. Last question. 10th question. Put yourself in a time machine looking back on your career, is Will McDowell White going to wear an NBA jersey?
Yes.
Yes.
At some point, he will. Even if it's just one time, he'll do it.
Yeah, I like that. Next thing we get into is our five fan questions. We chuck these on our story for our followers to ask you. The first one is a funny one. Who wins in the backyard 1v1s? You, Daryl, which sibling? Kobe. Who wins the ones?
Not Kobe. Kobe's too small. I don't know. Probably. Well, I'm going to say myself. But Daryl does put a good. He does put a good fight up. He can every now and then he'll beat me.
I was going to say, what would Daryl's answer be?
I mean, it should be me, but he probably
he'd definitely say himself. That's funny.
All right. Second question. I think it's from your little sister Haley. Who's your favorite sibling?
Oh.
Put you on the spot.
Everyone knows it's baby Scala.
How many siblings are there?
So I have seven.
Okay. So baby Scala gets the choice there. Someone asked, what were your grades like at school?
Well, I know the general, you know, assumption is they were terrible. Well, definitely when I started out high school, they were bad. Because I went to a prestigious high school in the beginning. Yeah. But in the end, they weren't that bad. I mean, I was probably just above average student. It was tough my senior year being away. I was only at school for like maybe a term and a half. So I didn't, it was tough to do that. But yeah, everyone seems to think I was a dumb kid, but I like to think I was actually okay.
What was the prestigious school you went to?
Churchy.
Oh, yeah, Churchy, right. Yeah.
Fourth one, man. You've answered this question already, so I'm gonna flip it a little bit. The question was originally, who's the best player you've played with? Obviously, you said Kevin Porter Jr. was a bit of a bucket, but who's the most underrated player you've ever played with? Someone doesn't get hyped, but you were like, or his teammate, and you were like, oh, my goodness, this guy's tough.
Oh, man.
Got to think about that one. He's played on a lot of teams.
Probably Armani Brooks, who played 19 this year. Armani Brooks, he's he can shoot the shit out of it, but doesn't get talked about at all.
Someone asked, are you going to bring the Breakers a championship?
Oh, I mean, I'm not going to say no, but yeah. The there now, it's going to be a bit. Going to have pretty much have a perfect end to the season for that.
Yeah, legit. Have you been watching the Breakers games?
Yeah, I've watched a couple. Man, they just seem to be a great first half team right now, and then they just get tired. Mm. No legs.
Corey Webster's out now, isn't he? He's got injured. Yeah. Anyway, we're going to wrap it up there. Thank you so much for joining us. I know it's time consuming, but we appreciate it, and we're definitely rooting for you this season on the Breakers. And yeah, hopefully you get the call up for the Boomers final roster. But yeah, thanks for joining us. We appreciate it.
Appreciate it.
No worries. Thanks everyone for joining us. Really enjoyed that episode. We think Will's going to go far. Definitely going to be a star on the Breakers. Appreciate all the support recently. Like, subscribe on our YouTube, means a lot. We appreciate you guys. We'll see you next week.
Appreciate it, guys. Take care.